I would like you to take a second to think about your city, the city you live in, and also about your daily life in your city. More specifically, about the places you like, and the places you like your home, a bar you like to go to, the restaurant you hang out, maybe a museum you often go, a park, etc. Also, now I would like you to think about the places you don't really like or actually don't really care about. A mall, maybe, your bank, maybe, I don't know, a lot of places, I guess. But if you think about it, if you add all those places, it kind of represents your entire experience of your city. And I bet in all those places, you didn't think about the vacant land. But vacant land is a category like the others, and it exists in every city, in every form and shape. It's sometimes privately owned, sometimes publicly owned. But they do have in common that there is nothing on them. There's no activity. They're totally empty. You could almost say that they are an urban black hole. Nothing exists on a vacant land. And I think that's why it's actually a really interesting category. It's one of the rare places in a city where you can actually project and imagine what it could be, because the place is nothing yet. It's an absolute empty category. It's just something that's going to become. And I think we are missing out on all those vacant land. What I mean by that is I think it's a huge opportunity for experimenting and trying stuff in our urban urban settings. And I really think that cities across the globe should facilitate the temporary use of vacant land for non-commercial purposes. So if you don't mind, I'm going to illustrate this with a really practical example. I'm going to take you back 5 years ago in New York City, more precisely in Brooklyn, more precisely at the exact border between Greenpoint and Williamsburg. There, you have an empty triangle that's been empty for as long as people can remember in the neighborhood. And so much so that the place is kind of known now. A lot of people know about that little triangle, and even a lot of people fantasize that one day they should do this or this on this land, and I'm definitely one of those person. I think the place has an incredible view on the city skyline, and it has some sort of magic that I cannot explain. But well, anyway, it's New York, it's daily life, it's really busy, and nothing happened on that piece of land. Until one day, in March 2015, I'm in the middle of a professional crisis. I'm a freelance photographer, videographer, etc. In New York, there's a lot of competition, and I'm not going anywhere. It's not going anywhere, and I have to be honest about it, and I'm panicking, and I need to think, and it's really hard, and I'm like, should I go back to Belgium? I don't know. So I go for a walk because I need peace in my mind. And kind of like naturally, I end up at the radio, at the lot, and that's when I see it. On the worst day of my life, like the lot is available for lease. Like I'm totally on shock. I can't believe it, and I don't believe in destiny or anything like that. But there, I'm like, this is insane. This is insane. I need to do something. And not 30 seconds later, it strikes me. It just hits me. It's absolutely clear, like crystal water. I'm opening an online music radio on that piece of land. I don't know how I got there, but now I understand better. It's because I was in New York since more than 5 years. Music is my first passion. I go out a lot, I go to a lot of concerts, I know what's happening, et cetera, in the city. But still, after 5 years, I was still listening to the same radio I was listening back in Europe, which is Red Light Radio, which is streaming from the Red Light District in Amsterdam, and NTS, who's streaming from Hackney in London. And after 5 years in New York, having witnessed all the incredible dynamic energy in all the different music scenes, all the incredible young talents and emerging talent that there is in New York City, I can't believe that there's no proper platform for those people and to welcome them. So that's when I decide I'm going to take all my love of music and all my energy to create this platform, to give New York a proper platform and give those people a proper platform. And that's where the vacant land is actually incredible, because it allowed me to even rethink the concept of online radio. It allowed me to really go crazy and imagine exactly what I wanted to do to get to my goals, etc., etc. So basically what I wanted to do, for me, Music is absolutely sacred. It's really something important in my life. It's something that I think should be protected in society in general. I think it's something that's above any daily thing, any daily concern, any political concern, etc. Music is extremely important, and I know like all my friends around me think the same. We're kind of all music lovers. And so I really think we need to protect music, and I decided that I need to create a real place to welcome music, but also to welcome all those people who think like me, like that music is incredibly important and that are totally in love in music, unconditionally in love with music. I want to create a place for all those people to meet. And also, what I want to do, I realize that a lot of those talents, those young talents, etc., they play at night, they play in clubs, etc., where there's an incredible creative energy. But I would love for all those people to be able to meet during the day, more calmly, more productively, like around a cup of coffee, etc., and I think it's important to have that. So that's kind of what I want to do. But bon, more practically now, I need to find where is it going to be, the radio? So, quite quickly, I decided that to use a good old regular shipping container, the 20-foot shipping container that you see throughout the world, design it for a few months and found people who actually did it. I couldn't do it, and we got it shipped at the radio one day. It was ready for the radio to take life. That took a year. It was really complicated, but I went fast. And so now I need to explain you two core ideas of the radio and why I think it makes this project so solid and somehow so successful, I think. And it's really important. First, the radio, the LOT radio, has to be financially independent. I knew it had to be. We had to find a way to sustain ourselves. And also importantly, we had to do it in a way. For what I mean, like the revenue couldn't come from the activity of the radio. I would never put an ad on the radio. There's no ads on a radio, and I would never put a brand on the container, etc., and stuff like that. Music is sacred. Music has to be protected. And so we went through a lot of different ideas, crazy ideas, but then at the end, only one passed the test. So basically, we kept on the left, we have the little studio, where fully functional radio studio where we stream from. And then on the right, we have what we call the kiosk. And the kiosk is a fully functional, self-contained coffee shop, beer and wine, little kiosk. You can also buy our t-shirts, etc., from there. And so that covers all of our financial need to be able to run the radio on a day-to-day basis. And I think this is key for two reasons. First, it allows us to step out of one of the strongest paradigms that you have in media broadcasting today, which is you need as many viewers as possible so you can go see brands and sell them those numbers. This is a tyranny we're not ready to go in. Absolutely not. So this is why we have absolute freedom on our content. We have a lot of extremely weird shows that may have like two listeners in Croatia, but if we think that the show is important or the person who's doing the show is important, we keep the show. And so that's one thing. The other thing, it's really relaxing to have that first financial thing settled. It means that we don't have to run all year long to brands and to find brands to do weird collaboration, to have some sort of budget, etc., etc. That doesn't mean that we don't do collaboration with brands. We do, but it gives us a critical eye and actually gives us the luxury to be able to say, no, we don't think it's interesting, we're going to pass on this, thank you. So that's one thing, and I think it's really important. The second thing is that the LOT radio is a URL in real life. What I mean by that is that the LOT radio has to be a bridge between the online world that it creates and the offline world that it creates. And it really needs to be a strong bridge between the two. And why I think it's so important is because if you think about the online world, it's extremely noisy. You can basically, to be honest, setting up a broadcasting and setting up an online radio, you can do it in three clicks. You can start broadcasting anything in three clicks. And that creates a lot of noise. And us, we needed to be different and stronger. And that's why it's in the word even, like it's an online radio station. The station has to be anchored in the community, in the neighborhood and in the city where it's streaming from. It's key to the strength of our radio, I think. So that's why, basically, our radio is open to the public as some sort of semi-public park every day, the same hours of the radio. But this is there's a little thing I wanted to explain here. That's kind of important, I think. So, I think too, also important. So basically, people can come and hang out, but you'll hear the music of the radio. But what's important to understand is that we never ask our DJ to adapt to the public or to adapt to the time of day that they are playing at. It's not a spectacle. People don't come to see the DJ. The DJ are there for themselves. It's their moment. They're in the little universe. They're in the little studio, and it's a moment for themselves. They can play Gabber for 2 hours, or they can read poetry. It's their moment. So, and that's really important too, I think. So, with those principles well anchored in our mind and the structure established, and also after I surrounded myself with key people who formed the core team, key people who understood the project and also had the same incredible love of music that I had. So with that team and that structure, we did a test run. That's the first day of streaming. It's a Sunday afternoon in Brooklyn in the winter on February 2016. It was supposed to be just a test run to test all the gear, make sure the streaming was working, etc., with a few DJ friends playing. But actually, the days after, the excitement in New York City and all the different music scene was such that since then, we never stopped streaming. And we got so many requests of incredible people who wanted to be on board that actually we had to set a limit. We are streaming live with people in the studio playing music for you from 8 a.m. In the morning until midnight every day, except on weekends we start at 10 a.m. But that's when, and then the rest of the night, we replay shows of the week. So basically, you have 24 hours of incredible music without any brands, interruption, etc. They sometimes do interview and stuff like that, but basically about music. And thanks to, and so now now we have around, I would say, more than 80 resident DJ who are people from all over New York City, all over different path of life, all different kind of music that are feeding this platform, and they're doing an incredible job. And we keep also 10 to 20% of the timetable, the weekly timetable, we keep it to be able to invite international guests that are passing to New York, because New York is still such a cultural hub. For us, it's incredible. We are able to invite incredible people on that radio, and it's a huge pleasure. And that means that thanks to that structure, etc., in 2 years and a half, I really think that we managed to become one of the leading independent music online radio stations in the world. And also, thanks to that structure, I really think that we managed to do a bit more. It's hard to explain, but the Lot Radio now, we managed to turn an empty piece of land that you saw at the beginning, there was nothing, there was trash on it. In less than 3 years, we turned that piece of trash place into a vibrant community hub. Everybody comes and hang out there. You don't have to know the DJ or know anyone to come. People come and read, people come and hang out. You have mothers coming with their kids, dogs, etc. It's extremely diverse, and everybody kind of feel at home. And it also attracted a lot of other initiatives. A lot of people were touched by what we did. And so we managed to, I don't know, it attracts a lot of other good energy. And just a few examples, but for example, we try to do a lot of things with arts. And here, we're honored actually and really lucky to have two Iranian brothers, Aisi and Sot, who are really talented artists, who proposed us to do, they're friends of ours, and they proposed to do a site-specific installation for us that's at the tip of the little triangle, and we're extremely happy to have it. That's just one example. Also, the first year we realized that we were right in front of the 4th of July Independence Day in the US fireworks of New York City, and that was just with friends. And so the next year we decided that we were going to organize an annual block party of the Lot Radio on that day. So this is the first edition, and this is the edition this summer, just last summer. And now it became really something in New York City. People go to the block party of the Lot Radio because it's the best place to see the fireworks also. And also we're extremely lucky, I forgot about that, sorry. The only active neighbor we have on that little triangle is actually a Roman Catholic church right across the street, and we're really lucky. It's run by two extremely open-minded and friendly Franciscan brothers, fathers, Father Nick and Father Raphael, and they allow us to use the church as a concert venue whenever we feel like it. So we're able to invite up-and-coming artists of New York or international to do really special concert in the church. And this is just, we're extremely lucky and thankful. They do the bar when we do the event, so it's a win-win. But we're extremely thankful of that. But anyway, this is the Lot Radio. It doesn't fit in any category. It's a radio, it's a bar, it's a park, you don't know. And I think that's why a lot of people are touched by it and a lot of people want to find it. It found a place in a lot of people's heart because it's not about business, it's not about like anything else. What ties everything together, though, it's this sacred love of music. Like music and music lovers is what makes that little radio run every day and the success that we have. And that's what I wanted to say. This, we did this on a little piece of land in New York City in 2.5 years. So imagine how urban life would be more exciting and interesting if people all over the world and in every city would take over little piece of land and try stuff out. That's just what I wanted to say. Thank you.